ngiyabonga kakhulu ukuthi ngibe nani namhlanje. Ngifuna ukuqala ngokuthi ngixolise ngoba kukho la ngizawujahela khona. Ubaba uBezos oye wathi ma i-ANC ibhekene namacala e-Rivonia trial wabadefender. Namhlanje u-10 90 years old. Ebengicelile ukuthi ngibe khona ngokuthi ngakhona. Ngothi ma ngifika lapha ngithi la mvela khona eval bayabulisa bathi hey thada. Ngifuna ukuthi nginazise kubantu engihamba nabo obona abanazi nani nibazi. Lana nginamalungu amabili we-council yami kule campaign yami abantu abancedisana nami. Owokuqala uGodfrey Oliphant. Member ye parliament, a deputy minister ye minerals.
So eta president Sisulu eta. Eta president Sisulu eta. Amandla.
Manje ke okamnandi akho ma minerals la. So ningamvalele khoneni. Ngiphinde ngazise uPhaki Cimiya. UPhaki uphuma e-exile. Uyilungile lomkhonto wesizwe le besikhuluma ngayo khona manje. UPhaki uphume e-Eastern Cape. Manje-ke isiSuthu nesiZulu akasazi kahle kodwa namxolele uzazama ukuthi akhulume. Ngoba ngizawusheshe ngihambe ngizawucela ukuthi ngishiye nabo. Ngifuna sixoxaxoxisane ngoba isikhathi sokuthi sixoxaxoxisane si-ANC sinqabile. Sihlangana ney'ndaba sezisestradeni kanti sikhona nje sikhona singabe sizikhuluma sizibona ukuthi siyakuphi ngoba bonakala nje ngoba asibatholi asiwatholi amathuba ukuthi sihlale kanje sixoxaxoxisane. La-ke kusekhaya kithi-ke la Everton la Evan le encompassa i-Everton. Ubaba wami ebenomhlaba la Everton okusho ukuthi-ke uma sithi sifuna umhlaba ubuye nibokwazi ukuthi nowafuna umhlaba ninawo la e-Everton. So ngiyacela ukuthi uma sesesiwubuyisile umhlaba niwufune wami nifeze niwubeke ecaleni ngibekele wona ba ngabuya. La kule ndawo le kula bekuba khona ama-youth league conferences amaningi. So sihambe-ke sikhaphe komuntu omdala-ke. So yindawo bengizihamba-ke kakhulu-ke le. Ngithokozile ukuthi ningibuzile ngafika lana esithi beki ngizokhuluma nani. Ngize ngizogubha i-100 year ka-Oliver Tambo. Siniphathele ikhekhe. Ngizocela ukuthi nibashiyele nalaba be-branch abasabhizi nge-BGM ukuthi sibashiyele ikhekhe bangakwanti kakhulu ukuthi siqhube bengekho. Comrades, this is a very historic place that we stand on here, Sidibeng. This is a place where the Wilberforce Institute, established by Charlotte Matlage, served as a center for political activity in the 1940s and 1950s. Note that this institution was established by a woman. Long live women, long live!
Long live!
The first Everton bus boycott of 1950 was the beginning of a whole series of successes. The second one, which was between June 1955, which ended in 1956, was a huge success for the people of the area under the banner of the ANC. Soon, the Kliptown, Western Areas, and Alexander Bus boycott followed in 1957. In all of these, the protests, the ANC and the Youth League were central to that. In short, this area has played a meaningful role in the liberation of our country. That is why Nelson Mandela decided to sign the new democratic constitution in Sharpeville on the 10th of December in 1996 as a public acknowledgement of your sterling struggles. Siyabonga nonke. We are also pleased to note that at the recent local government elections, you won and are governing without any coalition. Ngifuna ukubonga wethu. Ngithengi driver ngizalana ngahlangatshezwa izindlu nje eziningi ngabona ukuthi no siyaqhuba isithi be siyaqhuba ngikhumbe njalo. The year of the birth of O.R. Tambo was a very eventful year in the annals of the 20th century. Because that year was eventful, the people who were born in that year were to shape human history in more ways than one. In 1917, the Russian Revolution broke out with Vladimir Lenin leading the Bolshevik Revolution that overthrew the Tsar, Nicholas II. In that same year, Sun Yat-sen took over the Parliament of China and established a military junta. These were some of the global events that formed the context of the birth of O.R. Tambo. In later years, both the events in Russia and China were to have a lasting impact on his life. O.R. and his colleagues were to spend many days in these two countries, and some of his comrades were buried in Russia and only recently brought back by the Minister of Arts and Culture. These were Moses Kotane and J.P. Marx. Why do we remember O.R.? The process of remembering is not an involuntary exercise. It is a conscious act. It is born out of a compelling desire to be fulfilled. We remember people because we want to honor them. We remember people because we want to step in their footsteps and make sure that their work is never forgotten. We remember events that both have a meaning and those that hurt us. We remember people who have made a lasting impression in our lives and those that have left scars in our lives. Comrade Lorna, quite clearly the scar I left on his heart was not putting him fagging Sabalasu, but a putting his age or killing him now to move in. Kodwa masibonge ukuthi ubuyile namhlanje uyisotsha lomkhonto siyabonga malibongwe igama lomkhonto malibongwe. We remember him as a soldier and a freedom fighter, O.R. Tambo. We fondly remember him as a devoted leader and a champion of our struggle. We loved him. We wished him and his life in abundance forever, but unfortunately, we had to let him go. We composed songs about him. He represented to us the fresh rays of the morning sun that the Basutu call Mpatasana Naledi. Yeah. Whatever. Mtosa, mina, whatever is I chopede. The Tosa people call it Ngwengwezi Yekwezi. Tambo meant the future to all of us, and we struggled for a just and free society. The making of O.R. Tambo. O.R.'s biographer, Luli Kalinikos, indicates that the passion that burned in O.R. Tambo was to live beyond the Engeli Mountains, because the area he was born in Ngandoro, was bounded by Engeli Mountains. Little did he know that not only would he go beyond Ngandoro, he would actually shape the course of history. He was reviled and he was amazed by the system that was abandoned at that time. He was Christian in faith and he believed in the gospel of equality before the Lord. O.R. was angered by the racism that was all around him, its cruel nature that separated human beings on the basis of color. But O.R. was inspired by his teachers who believed in him and encouraged him to succeed. What we learn from this is, for our youth, it is important at all times that they are encouraged, that they know that you believe that they will succeed, because they are our future. This is a seed that we picked up on in O.R. O.R. valued education as a critical tool to liberate a people from ignorance and superstition. O.R. grew to become a total person in all manner of existence. O.R.'s entry into the politics of the country was drawn from his deep love for his people. He valued his people and treasured them all the time. He brought into politics a profound sense of morality and humanity. This is something I want you to remember. The name, the person that we are honoring the whole of this year. At the bottom of his heart, what he treasured most was humanity and morality. Nothing else. No state, no money. Morality. This is what he would like us to be in the ANC, to follow in his footsteps. It was this uprightness of character that endeared many to follow him at all costs. O.R. was a consummate teacher and a scholar par excellence. O.R. was one of two Africans who has passed his JMB and matric with distinction in maths and science. Mkhabelele Mlamuthi. A rural man from Ngandoro, passed, one of two people who passed with distinction in mathematics and science. Owen was a lateral thinker gifted with a beautiful mind. Owen's leadership was born by struggles of the people of South Africa through their organization, the African National Congress. Owen's leadership was hinged on a strong moral code of care and regard for all people, regardless of who they are. Owen led from the front, given the sincerity that he enjoyed a huge following. Owen faced conflict with determination and magnanimity, both in the ANC and outside of that. Owen was a confident leader, hence he did not need to please or appease anybody. A self-assured leader will stand rebuke and criticism as his actions are just and genuine. So at all times, look at your own actions. If they're just and genuine, walk tall in taking those decisions. Owen bequeathed onto the ANC a deep sense of high discipline and deep morality. He left a legacy of sacrifice and leadership for the people of his nation. He left a legacy of struggling and refused to coexist with poverty and corruption. He refused to coexist with corruption and poverty. That's what should drive us. What would Owen think of our present challenge today? What advice would he give to us as a movement? What would Tambo say about a fractured ANC, a fractured alliance? What would he say about all of us? What would he say about the divisions within us? He would sit down and say, think of the ANC first. Think how you take my people out of poverty into the promised land at all times. Rendering an address at the funeral of Owen Tambo, Nelson Mandela had this to say, and I quote, while the ANC lives, Oliver Tambo cannot die. While Nkomdo Wesizwe exists, Oliver Tambo cannot die. Oliver Tambo cannot die while his allies in the South African Communist Party and the Congress of South African Trade Union remain loyal to the common purpose, close quote. The unity of all of us is non-negotiable. This is what Owen left us with. The forces of reaction are fast gathering steam and momentum. The gains of our liberation are now called to question. There is a case in the Constitutional Court. It has been brought by Solidarity of the South African Restructuring and Insolvency Practitioners Association. The case seeks to test the constitutionality of both affirmative action and BEE. God knows what else will be challenged by those who are hell-bent to retain their apartheid status quo. Our job is to take the struggle forward at all times. Every day you go to bed, ask yourself, what have I done for this country? What have I done for the ANC today? We cannot concede the gains of our liberation just like that. We cannot lose ground that we've won by the blood of our martyrs. Our economy is at an all-time low. Unemployment is at its worst at 27%, most of these young people. We have a huge budget deficit that we are facing and another possible economic downgrade. Such times of gloom and doom call for new ideas, call for new ways of doing things, and they say to us, it is time to change. Such times of gloom and doom call also for new leadership. Leadership that is steeped in what is right, leadership that will take us out of our current situation. Therefore, we need to mobilize, fight on, and make sure that the last vestiges of apartheid are behind us. The gains of our freedom must not be compromised at any stage. The promise made to our people must be fulfilled, the promise of a better life. We cannot relent after so many lives were lost. We cannot abandon the struggle after so much has been suffered. We cannot continue in our conscience when so many were jailed and maimed. We owe it to those dead and departed. We owe it to the living and the unborn generations to raise the flag of the ANC even higher and higher, to ensure that the ANC lives and the ANC leads. We are at a very important point in our struggle today because in December we're going to elect that new leadership. We have an alternative, and the alternative is to articulate a radically different social order. A social order that recognizes that all of us are equal, men and women. This place has helped us clearly to unambiguously define the correct demands of our people. Accordingly, we have to address the needs and demands of the youth, the students, our women, our workers, the peasants, and the unemployed, as well as the urban and rural people, and indeed all black and white people who belong to this country. In 1994, it was not only freedom of our lifetime, but we changed it to say we want a better life for all our people. When you wake up in the morning, check around you, find out, have we given a better life for our people? If not, what are we doing to ensure that we can provide a better life for our people? Because all of us have a responsibility to live up to that responsibility. We are obliged, first of all, to return the values of the Freedom Charter, the founding document of the ANC. Our guiding principles, as on the day that they were written, are true to us today. And to put those values to the service of our people, our daily lives must be committed to that. If we do not give back to the ANC its moral credit, the social political structure of the country is going to be weakened like never before in the last decades. I have committed myself that I'm going to work so that the sacred foundations of the new South Africa will never be crushed by personal ambition, by corruption, by meanness, by arrangements made behind people's backs for any particular reason. Each one of us should commit ourselves, for as long as we live, the people of South Africa have somebody to save them in each one of you. The ANC was not born to satisfy any group of people. It was born to ensure that each and everyone feels that they belong equally. We are obliged to translate the Freedom Charter and give it concrete value, using those principles as a central guide so that every South African can feel and touch and live freedom and a better day every day. Sacred words, even more sacred when they are acted upon, are those that are written in the Freedom Charter, bringing fulfillment to people so that we may meet the promise of a better life to our people. We have a right to happiness and well-being, but we also have a responsibility to preserve it and make it true in our daily lives, and preserve it also for the youth in whom we hold this particular position. We as a people have gone through a great deal of pain and sacrifice, traversed lands our forefathers never dreamed of, buried our young. We refused to allow our hearts, broken so many times, to be filled with hatred. We chose lion's hearts, proud, strong, resilient people that we are. We chose to fill our hearts with hope, setting an example for all the people of the world to follow. We are directed to continue with that. I believe the time has come for all of us to stand together, shoulder to shoulder, to defeat all that threatens to end our dignity, our hard-won freedom, and our achievement, and our unity, and effect an improvement in the lives of our people. Let the torch of the revolution be reignited in our hearts. Let us allow no one to extinguish it, because this is all we have. This is all that has been left to us. This is all that we can give over to the young. I'd like you to stand with me on the Freedom Charter to offer hope, not condemnation of anybody, not slates of anybody, but to stand each one as an individual to say, what is it that I can do as a member of the ANC to make the next person's life a better life? The heritage of South Africa we choose to believe in demands that our unity be acknowledged as our only strength and the safest strength that we have. This attribute will we will not allow to be turned against us by any divisiveness. We will welcome those who wish to come to our late struggle. We will welcome them at all times and make sure that we are not allowing anybody to tear us apart. We have fought too long to allow any more divisions amongst us. Comrades, as I dreamed of a future South Africa, I put it down on paper and I want to share it with you because I'm sure this is a future that you too dream of. I dream of a South Africa, a country of freedom, equality, a country of fairness, a country of prosperity for all of these things that are expressed in the Freedom Charter. A country where there is food for the hungry, where we are all equal, not only before the law, but in our homes as well. Where there is land for the landless and the dispossessed. And while we say this, don't forget my land, La Pekvato. Where there is hope for the homeless, such as I've seen as I was coming here. Where there is health for the sick, and affordable health for the sick as well. Where there is care and tender attention for the elderly. Care for those who sacrificed for their lives for us to be here. Where there is work for millions of the unemployed. Where there are incentives for anybody who starts up an SMME to grow the economy. Where there is investment in our country so that we can have jobs for all. Where there is equal access to the resources of the country that we build as a nation. That the wealth of the country should be shared equally amongst all who live in it. I dream of a country that is a progressive realization of free education for all. Not only free, but compulsory. That every child of a particular age must be in class learning. Beyond that, every teacher who's paid by government should be in class teaching 8 hours a day so that we are successful. Where we have decent services and clean government from public servants who know they serve the interests of the people first. Where, most of all, we have equality for women. It has been indicated by the speaker that we still suffer triple oppression. This is a very subliminal kind of oppression, where what we articulate on a daily basis does not reflect what we live on a daily basis. And we women feel it most. We must emphasize at all times that there is equality for women in all spheres. Where there's inclusion for the poor and black majority, for the wealth of this country belongs to all. Where there's inclusion of vulnerable, of people who are women, children, and those who live with any disability. Where there is justice and equality for all and the protection against violence and abuse. Where there is inclusion of minorities and assurance that they belong. And respect for each South African equally. This is what I want out of a new South Africa. Is this what you want out of a new South Africa? Thank you. This is a South Africa that we can have, but most importantly, this is a South Africa that we should preserve for the future generation who look up to us to make sure that we hold steadfast to the freedoms that we have, we hold steadfast to the promises that we have. What we must do is to honor our forefathers, and the only way we can do that is to continue their dream of ridding South Africa of poverty, of ridding South Africa of corruption, of ridding South Africa of violence, of ridding South Africa of unemployment, of ridding South Africa of inequality, of ridding South Africa of racism, and ridding South Africa of any capture whatsoever in nature that is detrimental to our country and our economy. What we must do to finally liberate this people, to this country and its people, we must do, first of all, is to cleanse ourselves and know that we are here not for ourselves, but for the ANC and the people of this country. Because when we are united by that one principle, that we are here for the people, then we will never let them down. We will long hang on to the original values of the ANC, whatever the challenges that come our way. These challenges are worth facing, because every challenge we come across only makes us better people. These are challenges that are worth facing because our nation is going through one of its most difficult moments and our people are wondering why we are together. It is worth it because it is a cause that provides a sense of purpose and meaning and meaningfulness for all of us in our daily lives. It is worth it because South Africa and South Africans deserve the best. It is worth it because history calls on us, each one of us, every day, to give to the ANC what we can and what we owe to the ANC, to place the people and their well-being at the center of anything that we do. This we must do. That is why it is a must. We must stand up to make sure that our people who believed in us and allowed us to run this country to continue to believe in us so that in 2019 we're not wondering whether or not we're going to win the elections. We should stand firm knowing that we will continue to run this country for the next generation because that is a responsibility that we have taken. For me, it is a deep personal commitment to put the common South African men or women and their needs and their well-being at the center of Luthuli's dream, at the center of Mandela's dream, at the center of Thabo's legacy, and at the center of my life. I ask you to join me, each one of you, put the honorary ANC member at the center of what you do every day. Whatever you do, ask yourself, is it in my interest or is it in the interest of the ANC? If it is in your interest, think twice. Because what binds us is that we stand together to make sure that what we do benefits the ANC, benefits the future of this country, benefits the children that were promised a better life. We can no longer allow our party to be harmed in any way. We must make sure that we stand together because the consequences of allowing our party to be used for any other purpose except for the common man is too dire for all of us. What we need is a future of certainties. What binds us together is to create certainty not only for ourselves, for our economy, for the citizens of the country, and for our future. We need leaders who will guide the party and the country to a future of certainty its people demand and deserve. Leaders capable of inspiring men and women of all ages and beliefs of this country by rebuilding and strengthening each of them a realistic hope for the future and a better future for themselves and their children. Let people judge us by our collective character. I want to repeat that. Let people judge us by our collective character, not individual characters. Our collective character, which is the ANC. I would like for all South Africans the best life that we owe them. I want for all of them to give their best to the country. And I vow before you at all times that the ANC comes first in everything that I do, because it is a must. Thank you very much for this.
Well, there you have been watching the live pictures there of Lindiwe Sisulu, ANC NEC member and also presidential hopeful on the campaign trail in Vanderbijl Park in the south of Gauteng here in the Vaal. Speaking on several issues, saying that the Vaal has always had a central role in the liberation struggle, hence the constitution was signed in Sharpeville by President Nelson Mandela. Also paying tribute to O.R. Tambo, saying his life was guided by humanity and morality. She also lamented the court challenges against affirmative action and BEE and cautioning against the high unemployment and corruption, saying that the people of South Africa deserve a better life and calling for a return to the principles of the Freedom Charter, also calling on end to the divisions and factions in the ANC, saying that a united party and a leadership is what the people yearn for. And Lady Wesisulu, of course, one of several ANC presidential candidates who are crisscrossing the country, taking their message to supporters and branches that's ahead of the elective conference in December. We'll take a short break. I'll be back with more news at the top of the hour.